Hey Steve, how's it going?
Good, Deandra, how are you?
Good. It's finally sunny in Chicago. It has been so gloomy the last couple of weeks. How's the weather over there?
It's good today, but I tell you, we had a it was a it's been kind of a crazy spring. I mean, we've had a couple days up in 70, 75 or so, and then just this past Saturday we had I don't know how many thousands of trees down in a massive windstorm that came through. So we were
Oh
actually
my
down with
goodness.
our saws and chainsaws and handsaws and axes and stuff, and
What?
cleaning up down trees and branches. And it's all it's pretty rough out here. But it's now today it's a, it's just like a little slice of heaven today. So you never know.
Over there too? I
Yeah.
know. I feel like my kids keep saying, like, when's it gonna be spring? Is it gonna be spring? When,
Right.
what is spring? Because it's really been cold, like so cold that it's not even fun to go to the park. And I mean,
Yeah.
it's May, so let's get this nice weather going.
It's time, right?
Just in time for me to leave. All right, so let's check to see if we're live. I have a feeling that we are, but I'm gonna just double check here. Yep. I see people are on watching, so
Right.
let me
Hello, everybody.
Yeah, they're
Yeah.
coming. They are coming.
Nice.
All right. Yeah. So, hi everybody,
Long
and thanks
balls, and they
for.
want to learn about arsenals, huh?
They do. They are thirsty for what you have, and so am I, actually. And so it's 12:01. Let's get this party started. Everyone out there in internet land, I'm Deandra S. Beatty. International Art of Bowling. I have been on the Storm staff since 2011. I'm one of the fortunate ones to throw Storm balls. I also get to throw Roto Grip, which is awesome. Let's see, was on Team USA for 15 straight years. I won the 2012 Queens, and I am currently ready to go on the PWBA tour. It's starting up. I have all these really great options in the Storm line, all these new balls, and I just needed some help. I wanted to understand them a little bit better. I wanted to see what makes them different, how to what choice and when and why and how. And I thought there is no better person to ask than someone that is responsible for making these balls. So enter Steve Klumpkin. Hello, Steve.
Hi, Deandra.
A little bit about Steve, you guys. He's the executive director there at Storm of marketing, but he's more than that, really. I mean, he does it all, and he has helped develop these balls. He doesn't just pick the smell out, right?
That's a fun part of my job, but that's not all I do. That's right.
That's true. We did touch on that last time. You guys really loved what we did a couple years ago, or maybe it was last year. I think it was getting ready to bowl the Masters, and we did this Build Your Arsenal free webinar, and I've gotten so much great feedback. I mean, people are constantly finding me, strangers, and they're like, that one webinar you did with Steve at Storm, I just learned so much from it. So I know that this doesn't just help me, this helps all you guys out there too. But a little bit more about Steve. He has had some recent really awesome news, and I want to, congratulate him on the USBC Hall of Fame. What a dream.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks.
So cool. You just went to the induction a couple of days ago. You gave your acceptance speech, and oh my gosh, that is something I dream about. I mean, that would be really an amazing honor and really well deserved. I was so happy when they selected you, and you've just had such a great career. You're not just one thing, you're so many things, and one of those things is a great player. So congrats on that. Steve has also won the Open Championships twice. So that's two eagles.
Yeah, two eagles, yeah.
Wow, that's where are they? Are they on your by your TV, or where do you keep them?
Yeah, they're pretty special. I don't have a spotlight on them, but I've got a special place in my office there for them. Yeah.
Oh, cool. And two-time world champion and three-time collegiate national champion, which is cool because I know a lot of college players and high school players will be tuning in to this webinar to learn more about these Storm and Roto Balls. And you won three times at Wichita State University, huh?
Yep, go Shockers. Yeah, that's what we got. And we had many a good battles with Nebraska along the way, there's no doubt.
Yeah, that's the thing. When you have two powerhouse programs, they're always, it feels like they're always going to get there, right?
Yep, it is. So, you know, some of it's great coaching, some of it's great recruiting, some of it's, you know, the player skill level and somebody that's interested in kind of developing their game and getting the most out of, you know, their potential. You're going to be looking at a Nebraska or a Wichita State or somewhere like that.
Yeah, maybe we should do a college seminar one of these days. I think people would really like that too.
Yeah, I would love it, as long as we get dressed up in our old uniforms.
That would be hilarious. It's a great idea. All right, so let's get into it. I'm going out on this PWBA tour. I have all these great choices. Which one should be in my bag? And which are the ones that I should go to first and why? You know, let's start at the top. What do you have there on your desk for us?
Yeah, I've got a nice selection and a variety. But basically what I did is I picked out seven balls in advance for what I thought, and I also laid them out as well with the type of drilling relative to your PAP for what I thought would be a good choice. So I think what we're going to do to kind of help explain maybe some of the mindset and the thought process here is we'll start with the most, what I would call your biggest ball or the most aggressive one, the one that's designed to give you the most motion when either the oil longer, oil thicker, or you just need more hook. And that's going to be with our Alpha Crux right here. And what I want to do is show you exactly what these pin positions mean, what the mass bias position means, and what we call the pin buffer. Because all of our layouts, you know, if you look online or if you go through our drilling guide, you'll see, for example, when you open up that sheet or you open up the PDF, you can see here, for example, recommended layout 4x4x2. So we've got three specific numbers. So it's important to understand exactly what those numbers mean. Now for the Alpha Crux, we chose the 4x6x1.5 layout. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna explain that to you here. So a 4-inch pin to pap, and your positive axis point is 4.5 inches over and 1 1/8 inches up. So that's measured from your grip center. So here's your PAP. This is your PAP right here that I'm circling. So what we did first is we positioned the pin 4 inches from the PAP. Now, what does that mean? So in general, when we're looking at pin distance to PAP, we're looking at how much total ball motion we want to create. So we can put the pin in a very stable position, which would be, say, for example, if we put the pin on your axis, or maybe 1 inch from your axis, or maybe 2 inches from your axis, this is going to be pretty stable, and it's going to be something that we're designed to be a little bit faster revving type of a pin position. So it's going to rev up faster. We can also go with a little bit more of a stable position, but put it much farther from your PAP. And this is going to rev up a little bit later. And this kind of a pin position is generally better when we're playing a little bit more of a deeper type of an inside line when we're trying to get through some really, really kind of dry types of heads. So, and somewhere in the middle is an imbalanced position or something that's going to produce more flare potential, and it's going to create more total ball motion or more hook. So this type of a pin position, a 4-inch pin, is going to create a lot of motion. So this is going to be designed where we're trying to get your ball to arc off the break point and be kind of a strong continuous motion.
Okay.
And our second number right here, which is the sixth number, we're positioning the mass bias. So it's 6 inches from your PAP. Now, what that's going to do is that's going to help, again, complement and give you stronger continuation. It's going to give you a break point that's more near the back of the hook zone. So, you know, when we're looking at ball motion, you've got a ball, there's three different phases of ball motion. The ball skids, so it's through the skid phase. Then there's a hook phase, which is going to be where the ball changes direction and arcs. And then there's going to be, at the very end, a roll phase, which is where it goes into just a straight end-over-end roll. But it's hopefully going in the direction strong and rolling heavy through the pins. So we have skid, we have hook, and then roll. The second number right here, going with a further distance, a little bit longer distance here, means that we're trying to get that break point to be more near the end of the hook zone. And then our third number, is going to be this pin buffer, which is the distance of the pin to the vertical axis line. And when we have this number pretty short, which is 1.5, which is a shorter number, gets that pin much higher above the fingers, mm-hmm. you're going to see a change direction faster. So not only does it happen, the break point with this layout happen near the end of the hook zone, it happens a little bit quicker. So it'll look a little bit more like a hockey stick, a little bit more
right.
kind of an abrupt change of direction.
Okay. And that surface looks really dull. What's it at?
Yeah, this is at 2000. And that's important as well, because one of the philosophies, and I think one of the big misconceptions that happens with bowlers all the time, is they get, for example, they'll take a big ball like this, like an Alpha Crux or a Lock, right? And they'll think, well, this ball's pretty dull or it's pretty aggressive, so I'm gonna smooth up the cover stock, make it shiny so it doesn't hook too soon.
Right.
And then I'm gonna go with a more controllable, don't want it to hook too much. And then on the converse, maybe they take a ball like a match, and they think, well, this ball is not going to pick up and react to its stronger layout. What they end up doing is they'll end up making all the balls, they'll bring them to the middle left of them, and then they'll take their more controllable ball and they'll bring it in the middle by making them more aggressive.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you were to equate a set of 5 irons, instead of having a driver, a 5 iron, and a pitching wedge, you know, that we're taking a lot of people make that mistake, and they take the dynamics out of the aggressive balls, and they try and add dynamics to the more controllable ball. So that's one of the big things that I think when we're looking at understanding an arsenal and understanding layout, choose which balls is, you know, bowling balls that we have in the Premier line at the store, for HP4 for RotoGrip are designed to be aggressive and to create a better is going to complement what that ball's designed to do. So a big separation between our ball. So when we go to a tournament, you know, we don't always know what we're going to hit. Sometimes you may go there thinking, well, it's going to be this pattern, so I know that I'm going to need this. But different surfaces, different lane oils, depending on how you're throwing the ball that day, your most important thing when you go to a tournament is making sure that you have a variety.
Yeah, you know,
and that's kind of what we talked about from the onset here.
That Alpha Crux, I'll say that I have thrown it, and when I threw it first, I saw how dull it was. I was really nervous, and I thought, this with my ball speed, I'm not sure it's going to be a ball that I use a lot. But I was really surprised, because as the oil soaks into the ball, you don't need to overthrow it to get it down the lane. It actually now gets on the lane and has, for me, a really nice arc. So for those of you that look at a ball and immediately dismiss it, I want to really encourage you to give it a chance and get some oil in the ball.
Yeah,
it just kind
of... That's true. Yeah. That's a good point. And that's part of the reason too, you know, maybe adjusting or kind of scuffing up, sort of maintain whatever level of porosity they want on the surface of that ball.
Yeah. So talk a little bit more about like the specifics of this ball and the core and the cover and what makes it so special.
Yeah, this is in this, you know, the Alpha Crux, this is the third ball in the series that has the Atlas, which is a very fast revving, it's a very dynamic, asymmetrical, very strong asymmetrical. So this has a very low RG, the high differential and high asymmetry. When we're looking at putting this bowling ball together, we were looking at creating a strong, aggressive motion and shape. And, you know, we were just down there. We also had the first PWBA stop that was down at the Texas station. And actually, we were just chatting a little bit in the back. There were a lot of these balls that were going down the lane when the lanes were fresh, and when there was a lot of oil throughout the body before it started to break down. As soon as the lanes broke down, then you had to kind of get away from it. But there were a lot of the ladies that were using the Alpha Crux to start. And this is again, when we're just looking at this ball, it's designed for creating more ball motion. It's designed for when you want to emphasize the break point. And you want to be aggressive. You know, you want to get aggressive with your shot. There's nothing worse in my opinion, than when you go out in the lanes and you're trying to make your ball hook. You're trying to manufacture a hook. Because what happens, I mean, you know, if you're not throwing an aggressive enough bowling ball and your ball is slipping through and you're leaving 2-pin, 2-8, 10, 2-4, 5, something like that for a right-hander, what's your next inclination going to be? Kind of grab up right on it and steer yeah it. You have a tendency to miss inside, and then your shot-making quality goes down.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah,
this one really helps guard against. You can be aggressive with it. You can let it go. It's going to pick up and read the mid lane and then still continue through the pocket. So this would be our first one out of the bag on a heavier, longer oil type of a pattern when you're looking for a little bit more motion.
All right, great. Noted. Wrote down my notes. I hope you guys are writing down notes too. All right, on to the next.
Okay, so next, this would be your step down ball. This would be your ball number two, which I think you can see here is the Eternal Cell. And this is Rotogrip HP4 line, which is strong asymmetrical, strong asymmetry for HP4s in the Rotogrip. But what's the first thing you notice when you look at the difference here is that you'll see that the cover stock is a 1500 grip polished. So it's factory shined. So this one is going to be, even though it has a real strong motor in it, it's got that nucleus cell that every the core and all the cell series balls that everybody loves. And they're super versatile. You can lay them out a bunch of different ways. But this one, just because of the cover stock alone, is going to get through the heads a lot easier than the Alpha Crux. So as soon as the Alpha Crux starts to grab, then you can switch to your Eternal Cell, and then that'll get you back down the lane to the break point, but still provide a strong motion and back end.
Okay.
So we went with, on this layout, we went with a 4.5, the pin to PAP. Here's your PAP again. We went with a 4.5 pin to PAP, which again is still strong motion. Maybe it's a little bit later because we're a touch farther because it's our step down ball. And we went with a 4-inch mass bias to PAP. So our PSA to PAP is 4 inches. So 4.5 by 4 by 2, which again keeps us above the fingers. Okay. And that's something too, just from knowing you, DeAndre, over the years, and as far as layouts that work for you and your type of game, you get the ball into such a good roll that a lot of times you don't, that's why I didn't go with many pin down layouts, pin underneath the fingers, because a lot of times you get your ball into a real good roll anyway. Sometimes a pin down is better for people that are trying to get the ball into a roll because they read just a little bit faster. So that's why if you kind of see a little bit of that kind of common theme here, that's where it's also a matter of matching up the layout, not just for the ball, but also to your game.
Right. Yeah, that makes total sense.
Yeah. So this would be your step down ball. This would be ball one was your Alpha Crux. Ball two would be the Eternal Cell.
Okay, great.
It's still a pretty dynamic layout. Ball's going to hook, but it's going to break point when the heads start to get kind of chewed up a little bit.
And it is a little bit shiny, but if I have a hard time, maybe if I need the ball to kind of read a little earlier, I guess I could use that Alpha Crux. Or could you just knock that off a little bit?
Absolutely you can. Okay. You know, and we have I don't have the ball here set up for you. The ball hasn't come out yet, but we have a new ball that's being released called the Rocket Ship that actually has a new finishing technique we've never done before.
Oh.
It's the ball's actually, and then we take a little 3,000 grit pad and knock that shine off. So it's what you'll see a lot of the touring players do, a lot of professional bowlers. But sometimes it's just a little bit too clean to the break point. So in that case, you can take a passage earlier, but it's not nearly the same as like a 2,000 finish that's never been through the polisher.
Okay. That makes sense. All right, so two down.
Yes.
What's the next ball in the line?
So the next ball coming in here is going to be, we're sticking with Rotogrip here, it's going to be the High Wire.
Okay.
It's a hybrid cover stock. And we've also gone with, you can see here the factory finish is the same, but what you can't see difference-wise is what's on the inside, which is the core.
Mm.
This actually has, and I know you've thrown the Haywire before, which is a strong, fast rubbing symmetrical, but because it's symmetrical, it doesn't respond to the friction quite as fast as the asymmetrical. So this would be your next step down from the Eternal Cell.
Okay.
And you can see here, we're going to basically drill out the pin with your ring finger. For layout wise, we went with a 4x5x3 So 4 inches. So again, strong ample flare potentials, going to create some good motion. 5, meaning that we're trying to get the ball just a little bit down the lane, getting the break point a little bit farther down throughout the hook zone. And then with a 3-inch pin buffer, we're bringing it so it's a little bit more of a kind of a medium type of response. So it's not going to be quite as abrupt as you would get if the pin were a little bit closer to your VAL, meaning that it'd be farther above the fingers. We bring this down here, we're getting it so it's a little bit more of a slower type of a transition. So it's just not quite as, it doesn't change direction as fast. It's a little bit softer off the spot.
And what is that surface out of the box?
This is also 1500 grit poly.
Okay. I've heard so many people talking about this ball.
Yeah.
And I'm really excited to start competing with it because all of the reviews that I'm hearing are just super great. A lot of people are finding a lot of different lane conditions for this ball, which it's always nice to find a couple of balls that really work maybe on anything and everything.
Yeah. Yeah, that is. And this is actually the ball, the leader there for the first stop in Vegas for all 12 games of qualifying, Rocio, she used this for every game for all 12 games, which I'm telling you, it's very unusual. You know, that you'll see once in a blue moon that you'll actually see. But I mean, you know how many times you go through your bowl of block. A lot of times you'll throw 3 or 4 different balls across 60.
Let me tell you how awesome it is when you can actually find the ball and not have to worry about changing balls because you move a little here or there, you throw it a little faster or soften up or change your hand. I'm telling you, like, it is very rare to have those days, but I know I have had them. And I remember, at the Queens, I had those days where I Marvel Pearl in my hand and nothing else mattered.
That's a good feeling, isn't it? I know.
It is. Makes you bowl a lot more free.
It can loosen up that swing in a heartbeat, that's for sure.
Yeah. Yep.
So this would be your step down from the Eternal. And then this would be also, just because of the level of aggressiveness and where it's at and the type of layout we went, this would be one that you could almost say would be sort of like that middle benchmark kind of a ball. Like you had mentioned Marvel Pearl, which was a lower RG symmetrical cover stock wise surface prep. That's it. That's in that same ballpark. So don't be surprised if you find yourself kind of, you know, using the high wire maybe more than all the other balls in your arsenal. Yeah, it's
awesome.
It's a good one. There's no doubt about that.
Great.
Okay.
Great.
And now we're going to step down from here. So this is, again, we're kind of going back into the middle. We're going back to something with a little bit of surface, but difference-wise, again, we've got like a 3,000 grit finish here. But this bowling ball has, not only is it the largest volume, the biggest motor we've ever put inside a bowling ball, it's strictly a weight block. There's no core material, so the lightweight core material lowers the RG and makes it rev up real fast, which is like the alpha crux. This fight, even though it gets through the heads really nicely, so don't be surprised if you see this one really get down the lane good. That's because of that weight block design and the it's kind of a technical term, but we call it the radius of gyration. So it's where that center of gravity is located in reference to the geometric center of the ball. So this one has the mass located more towards the surface, and this one's going to rev up later. This was also a real big popular ball at the PWBA Spat down in Vegas this last weekend. So,
and what does it smell like, more importantly?
Smells like awesome is what it smells like.
We'll have to have the scent discussion too, because everyone's talking about, you know, if they were to choose what scent is in their ball, what would they choose? And I still think baby powder.
Yeah, that's a good one, right?
Then I could feel like my kids are always with me. They're, and it would remind me of them.
That's right. Well, we might have to make that happen, Deandra. We'll see what we can do.
Yeah, okay.
So this one here, you can see layout-wise go, we have 5 by 3.5. So this is a 5-inch pin. So this is actually the farthest from your PAP from all the balls you've seen so far. And we wanted to make sure that we brought this out too, because a 5-inch pin is very important for better bowlers, because if you get the ball flaring too much too soon, you're not going to see that motion off the break point because it's going to use its energy up a little bit sooner. Mm-hmm. And the other important thing when you look at this layout is there's a lot of people, when they look at, say, pin above the fingers, if you're right-handed, you can see here that we actually put this pin on the left side of the center line of your grip.
Right. And
there's still people that are confused thinking that if the pin's on the left side, negative. It's bad, or it's negative, or something like that, that it has to always, for right-handers, has to be on the right side.
Yeah.
It's all in reference to where your positive axis point is, okay? So it's all in reference to your PAP. So, like, let's say, for example, your PAP was here, mm-hmm. and then we did a 5-inch pin, the pin would be over here. And this is where you've seen Chris Barnes and Mike Fagan a lot of times. They'll use pins that are way over here. That's because their track is a lot lower, and their measurement, their horizontal measurement on their PAP isn't near as far.
Right.
But as long as you do your layouts based off of your PAP, then you know that you're going to get the ball motion that you're looking for. So don't reference it off of the grip center saying that, well, it has to be on the grip line or it has to be left or right. What matters is how far all these components are positioned relative to your PAP and your vertical axis line. Okay?
Yeah.
And so we had the 5 by 3.5, and then we went with a 2.5-inch buffer here, which again gets it so there's still a little bit more responsiveness so you kind of see it down lane. Mm-hmm. Because that's what happens as you go down, as we're stepping down, you're trying to make sure that as the heads break down, what happens in conjunction with the heads breaking down? The oil has a tendency of kind of carrying down, especially as we shoot our spare shots, our plastic or our urethane balls kind of drag the oil down the back of the pattern. So the back end starts to play a little bit tighter as well.
Okay.
So that's another thing too, another reason why we might want to, hey, let's make sure we can see something that's going to be the back end and is going to give us a little bit more corner, a little bit more shape down lane. Now keep in mind as well too that if this surface is a little bit too dull for you, we can go the opposite as well. Just like we can knock the shine mm-hmm. high wire, we can also take and smooth the fight up a little bit as well too. So you're going to have to get out there and kind of assess, you know, the ball motion and see if it's slowing down too soon or if it's just, you know, just about right.
Okay.
Okay.
And I know that you've been bowling a lot lately this year and you've had a lot of success. You won the state doubles with your own Storm's own Leanne Hulzenberg.
Yeah.
And I want to know, like, what are you using in your arsenal right now?
Yeah, sure. No, that was a good one. That was we ended up shooting over 1,500 in the doubles, so it was a great team effort. And actually, Leanne was using the phase all three games. She was a little bit right of me, and that one, that ball gives a little bit more control. I was actually using a Crux Pearl. And I was probably my lay down was probably about 3 boards deeper than hers, going out to about the same point. But because I was using a stronger asymmetrical that's going to corner harder than the phase does, I was able to kind of open up that back end a little bit more. So yeah, the Crux Pearl was a really good ball. And then we also have what's called the Storm Northwest Tour here that at Storm we sponsor a bunch of tournaments around the Northwest. So we had a tournament in Butte, we had a tournament in Ontario, Oregon. We also had one that we sponsored here that was in Layton, Utah at Hill Air Force Base. And I've been using, the Fight has been a good one for me here. I've also been using not just the Alpha Crux, but I've been using a couple of the lower end balls in the Roto Grip line too. We've got a real good HP2 ball in Roto Grip that's called the Hectic. And I think that's one that you're going to find some good use for. It's kind of complements in Storm. It's kind of similar a little bit to the Match Pearl, but it's one for later in the tournament, and this is a center up there in Butte, Montana, that's really known for, it really kind of burns up, the heads get dry, it's a kind of a hooking surface, and you got to have something that's really going to get through the head. So I've been using that Hectic quite a bit too. It's been a real good ball for me. But you know, if I look at my one benchmark ball that I just can't goes with me everywhere, is the IQ Tour. You know, it's just,
yeah,
it's,
you and everyone else. So.
Oh, it's been in our line for 4 years now, except for the high road. It's been in our line longer than anything. And
don't let it go.
I know. Well, you know, thanks to everyone's support, as long as the balls are still popular and still selling, and people are there's a demand for them, we're going to keep making them just like the high road. And IQ Tour is kind of, it's almost becoming the new high road now.
But don't get rid of that high road either. Keep it forever.
Can't do it.
All right, so we've got the Alpha Crux, the Eternal Cell, High Wire Fight.
Yeah.
Now we're going on to.
And now we're going to the High Road Pearl.
All right.
So we've got the pearl cover stock that's highly polished. And, you know, ball motion wise, you know, the original High Road could fit in this spot, you know, just as well too. That would also be another good option. But wanted to make sure that you had basically one ball here. You can see pin position again, like the fight, we're going with that big 5-inch pin position. So it's going to be cleaner through the front. It's going to delay that motion. And we've also positioned and kept that center gravity and that PSA a little bit farther away from your positive axis point, which this type of a layout here is going to give you a late break point. It's going to give you a sharp change of direction. In this one here too, if you want to get your hand around the side of it a little bit and get a little softer, mm-hmm. it's not going to respond and read too soon. It'll still float down the lane and then utilize, you know, you'll see a lot of its motion through the back end, and it'll give you the most entry angle. And you know, it's just one of my favorite choices, whether it's the Pearl version or the hybrid version.
Yeah.
You just can't go wrong. You really can't.
Yeah, I love that ball, and it's I've had two in my arsenal for many years, or however many years it's been out, and I have, you know, a pin up and pin down, and I just feel like, okay, when the pin up is a little too early, I'll just switch right to when the pin down is too early, yeah. I'll switch right over to the pin up, and it'll just give me that extra length and not have to really move that much with it. I love that ball through the pins for me.
Yeah, it's great through the pins, and that's the other thing too with the pin carry. You know, these balls have, because there's no core material, it's just a thicker shell, mm-hmm. a little bit more energy transfer from the ball to the pin. So there's a lot of people, you'll notice, they might say that they feel like their pin carry is a little bit better. Maybe they get an extra messenger, the head pin flies across the deck a little bit more with this ball. That's why that happens, yeah.
And truth be told, I really love it because it smells delicious. Just saying.
Good stuff.
Good choice on that one, Steve.
It's one of the most fun parts of my job. It is. You get the fragrance. We're super lucky to have that patented technology because it's awesome.
Yeah. So for those that didn't see our first one, and if you didn't see the first one of these that we did, you should look it up on YouTube. Because there's a lot of great information in there too. But we talked a little bit about the scents, and why don't you just quickly talk to us about the process of choosing a scent and how hard it is, and how you have all these scents in your office. And I mean, it must be overwhelming, because I know when you smell too many things, how can you smell anything then?
Right. Yeah, that's true. And that's, you know, it's funny too. And I'll just show you real quickly. This is, and I do have lots of fragrances, but that's what this little shaker is for right here. So that's actually one of the things that people that are in the fragrance industry do. Is when they bring out a bunch, they bring out a sample of 10 or 15 or so, you have to, it kind of cleanses your palate a little bit.
Yes.
It's like the ginger, right? Like if you eat sushi, it's like palate for your next piece. So, but there, it is funny because there's 20, like when we have a couple different vendors that we use, one of the companies, they have 27,000 different fragrances in their catalog. And they'll bring us maybe 15 or 20 to analyze or determine at a time and say, hey, we developed this new one. Or let's say we tell them, hey, we're bringing out a new ball that's two-tone blue. So we want to get something that has like a blueberry kind of tie with the color, you know, kind of matching. But the one interesting thing is that when you smell whatever fragrance sample it is, it's a lot easier when they put that fragrance in like a wax for like a candle. When you put it in a cover stock, because the urethane, the reactive material in here actually changes the way that comes through when it combines, when you mix it all together. So sometimes, you know, we've had fragrances that smell just terrific. There's one that we had asked for a bacon smell. Great in the bottle.
Uh-huh.
You put it in the urethane, it smells like, when it comes out, it smells like, and I don't mind this, but it smells like a campfire, kind of like when you put it out, like a little smoky, but it does not smell like bacon. The way that it tastes, you know, so that's been a tough one.
That was going to be my next question. How many times have you smelled it in the bottle and you're like, this is perfect for this bulb? and then you make it and you're like, that is not
what I was.
That is not going to work.
Yep. And that does happen a lot. Yeah. That's quite a bit. And then sometimes we can just change up, you know, increase the, concentration, for example, and it takes care of it. And then there's other times you increase the concentration and it just smells like more like stronger, but still the wrong smell. It doesn't change it any. So that's something that we definitely enjoy playing with.
Steve, we lost your video somehow.
You did?
Yeah. I wonder if it's just me that can't see you. So we'll just talk about sense a little longer.
I can see myself on the right hand screen.
So. Okay, good. I don't know. Maybe it's just my screen.
Hopefully everyone else can still see me.
Yeah. And for those that are listening, write your favorite sense or sense that maybe Storm should consider in the box, the comment box or the chat box if you're watching live, so that we can look over them and maybe you can give them some ideas. And for those that haven't been to the Storm site, you should for sure go to stormbowling.com. All of the information that we're going over today as far as the dynamics of the ball and the cores and the covers and the scents, it's all at stormbowling.com. So don't forget to check out their website. Okay, so I'm not sure why you're not showing. I think they see your dog, but that's okay. Unless you wanna, maybe you can drop off and come back on. Do you wanna try that? Why don't you hang it up and then just click that link that I sent you earlier and you'll come back on and I'll keep everybody entertained.
Okay.
All right. So while we're waiting for Steve, I want to talk to you guys about, you know, having a really solid arsenal is super important to excelling in your game. But something else that's really important to excelling is your mental game. And the International Art of Bowling has developed this 8-week online course to, it's called Mind Bowling. And you can find it at iabowling.com /mind-bowling. And it's literally an online 8-week course to strengthen your mental game. And it's something that Jason Belmonte and I put together. We made a lot of videos. We contacted a lot of sources like Dr. Dean. And we put together something that we really feel will step up your mental game. So don't forget to check that out. And Steve's back and I can see you.
Yay.
All right. Technology.
I get to see a picture of Zola. She's awesome.
She is beautiful. She is. All right. So we talked a little bit about scents. Any secret scents that you can tell us, or is that all under wraps?
That's something that people are really excited about hearing when we launch new balls. So sadly, I can't give away any of the ones we have lined up that are coming up in the future. But know that it's good. They're gonna be some good ones. There'll be some talk.
Good. Maybe you can bottle sunshine. Is there a scent for sun, or maybe rain?
We have had. I'm telling you. Out of 27,000 that we've got to choose from, they've got one of everything known to man.
Oh my gosh. That can be overwhelming. And it would probably give me a headache after a while of smelling them all.
It definitely can.
Yeah. Okay. So we've got, for those just tuning in, Alpha Crux, Eternal Cell, High Wire, Fight, High Road Pearl. And were you done with the High Road Pearl? And I think that you kind of covered the layout, you covered what it's supposed to do. I chimed in and said that I love it. So is there anything else you want to add to that? I think we have a little delay.
The only thing I guess I want to provide. It's going to create more hooks.
Sorry, guys. Hold on, Steve. We can't see you anymore, and we can't hear you very well. Let's drop off and come back.
Can you hear me now?
Oh, yeah, that's better.
Okay.
But I can't see you. Oh, wait, yeah, you're good. Okay, we're good. Okay. I don't know if I can't just hear what you just said, but you wanted to say that again?
Sure. Yeah, let's try it again. Okay. And hopefully the network connection's okay. Actually, I just had a little thing popped up. The network is a bit of an issue. So, okay. So hopefully we can get the storm line. When you look at the different lines within our product line, we have a Premier line, Master line, Thunder points, but they're also performance characteristics. So if you're looking at the Premier line, for example, you're going to have strongest coverage, new technology innovation is going to be there, and that's going to be best when you're trying to get more hook and more motion, especially when the lanes are tighter, when there's more oil, or whether it's a longer oil pattern. That's when you need best to use those type of bullion balls. So that's Premier line.
Okay. Hopefully everybody heard that. I kind of got bits and pieces of it, but let's move on to the next ball. So again, we're creating an arsenal right now, focused on me going out on the PWVA tour, knowing what ball to choose, when, what layouts, and why. So we've got a couple more left to do. And what is up next after that High Road Pearl?
Yeah, next up after the High Road Pearl, which is going to be our least aggressive or most contrived, is called the Match. And this has been a really ball. There's been some big successes of late, huh? But this time, this is a more stable cord design in it, so it's gonna allow you to stay a little bit closer to the break point and a little closer to the inside. Okay.
Hey Steve, can you hear me?
Is gonna get a breakpoint stable. How are you?
Yeah, your video, your
can you hear me?
Yeah, it's going in and out though. I can tell that your internet connection is I think probably weak. Do you want to try to drop off and come right back on again? Because that seemed to help last time. You want to try that?
Yeah, let's try that one more time.
Okay. Sorry, guys. You know, technology. Just to remind you, stormbowling.com, check out their website. Also, International Art of Bowling, iabowling.com. We are focused on creating a lot of really cool tools and resources for you guys to improve your game. So, like I said, Mind Bowling is one of them, iabowling.com/mind-bowling. All right, Steve, let's try this again.
Let's hope third time's a charm. We'll see.
Okay, that seems better. All right, Match.
Okay, so Match. So in this ball has been getting a lot of accolades as of late. I mentioned when we're looking at dynamics, we're also looking at, you know, what the flare potential and ball path, intended ball path is. The flare potential in this ball is much less, so it's a more stable design. Your ball, this type of layout we're in here is going to allow you to stay a little closer to where your lay down and break point is. As the lanes break down, you may be forced to move deeper and deeper and deeper inside. This Match will allow you a little bit out more to the right for you, and help you control the break point, not have to get so steep with your launch angle.
Okay.
In the layout we did here, we were talking right from the onset about as far as pins being in a stable position. This is a 2-inch pin in the path, and this is what we would call a more sort of arky, rolly, stable type of a layout. So 2x5x1, the 2-inch pin is going to allow you as well to create kind of a faster revving, but a little bit more stable type of a ball reaction. So it's going to keep some of that, where some of these other balls are going to turn the corner and kind of go a little bit stronger towards the pocket. This ball is going to want to give you more control down lane.
Okay, great. Everyone can use that, right?
Absolutely. And this is something that really every competitive bowler should have at least one ball in their bag, maybe even two, with the pin closer to their axis. You know, a lot of times, you know, we're always looking for the big skid and the big snap, but there's a lot of times the lane conditions just don't allow it. And it's more conducive to have something that rolls a little earlier and mm-hmm. then gives you a little bit more stability and control on the back end.
Great. Yeah. You know, so many times bowlers want their ball to skid flip to see that hockey stick motion, but that's not always the answer. You know, having your ball start a little bit early and be more archy, especially on the patterns that we're seeing these days, I feel like is the way to go.
Yeah. And that, the other thing too, is that, and you're right, that's a good way to go. And sometimes it's a good way to go in game one, because sometimes the back ends are super clean and all your balls just really snap. This one will control the back end. And then there's other times you can go through the block and the lanes dry out and they kind of transition. And you just have to get to a spot where you know that you can kind of line up a little straighter to the pocket and the ball's going to stay on that line and just give you that smooth arc. So it's kind of a dual
repeat it. That's great. Cool. All right. So on to is this the final one?
Yeah, the final one, which would be our seventh ball.
Yeah.
Which would be... We had mentioned that this one was a dual purpose ball. You know, we were talking before about you could use it fresh when the back ends are really dry, or you could use it when they're broken down and you're just looking for more stability. The Pitch Blue is a great dual purpose ball because this one, it's called Control Plus, but it's a urethane ball. Okay. It has a stable core in here, so it's not going to flare a lot. This is the second ball in the family, the Pitch family, if we call it that. The Pitch Black was the first one that we introduced a couple years ago, and it was designed, you know, you're a World Bowling Hall of Famer, and World Bowling, they bowl on short patterns. A lot of times you competed on 33, 34, 35 foot patterns.
Yeah.
We saw a trend where there were bowlers looking for old technology. They're looking for old urethane balls, because all the reactives were just, you know, snapping way too much. But if you picked up a new plastic ball, it would just go, you know, it would be too weak. If you did hit the pocket, it wouldn't carry and you were kind of fighting. So the original Pitch Black is one that we developed specifically for those short patterns. Now the Pitch Blue, this is one that you may have seen Jesper just used it on TV.
Yeah.
This one gives you a little bit more back end, but it's still not that reactive back end. So.
Right.
If the pattern's short, if the lane surface is kind of beat up, a lot of people bowl in wood centers. This is a good option for wood centers. There's still some wood centers around. But this one, too, can be used. You just flatten it out just a little bit, and it works great for your spares, too. So it doubles as a spare ball. So there's a lot of tournament players are using, you know, they're bringing an arsenal. Let's say they bring 4-6 balls, and they'll have a spare ball that also can be used as a strike ball, depending on what kind of condition they're hitting as well. So that's why I say this is a good dual-purpose one. And it does come a little bit on the dullish side, but don't think of it as being a dull, high-performance reactive like your Alpha Crux. Just give it a shot, let it soak in a little bit of oil. It doesn't have near the porosity of a high-performance cover stock. So it'll get a little bit smoother and shinier, and that will be one of the, like I said, it'll be a great dual-purpose ball for you.
That's awesome. And all of this information has been really great, and I know it's super helpful to me. Before we go, we do have a couple of questions, so why not get to those? Someone's asking the best 5 storm balls to take to nationals.
Ooh, that's a good question. And the one thing that I can tell you is that, and I know I mentioned it before, but the people that have gone there that I've spoken with, IQ Tour, whether it's an IQ Tour Solid or IQ Tour 30, is a very good choice. The high wire is also a good choice. It's a lower RG symmetrical, has a little bit more flare potential than the IQ Tour and IQ Tour 30. But the important thing to understand too, looking at nationals, and if you look at the scores, there's a good score, a high score, pretty tough to beat in the singles. But if you look at the scores in the team event, you look at the scores in the doubles and the all events, they're all attainable. And there have been a lot of good bowlers that have gone through there, you know. There's whether the Matt McNeils and Sam Lantos, the Lins Laker team just pulled this past weekend. Chad Nelson, also from Minnesota,
yeah,
has been through there. You saw the Eric Vermilia's team. A lot of great players have gone through there, and the scores are not that high. And when the scores aren't high, there, that tells you one thing too. There's really not one magic ball. A lot of it's going to be on execution. A lot of it's going to be on strategy. But make sure that you do bring a variety when you're going there, because you do have the lanes do transition a lot. Where they start at in doubles is not anything close to how the lanes finish when they're singles. So you got to make sure that you do have some step down balls. So yeah. I'd make sure you bring one. Make sure you bring one asymmetrical with you, and it could be an Alpha Crux that's kind of smoothed out a little bit. It could be a Crux Pearl would be a good shot. I guarantee I'm going to bring my Crux Pearl with me out there for my kind of my high end asymmetrical. I'm going to have two, three balls in that middle range. So IQ Tour, which is a solid, has a little bit of texture. IQ Tour 30 would be a great option to balance that out. Then you have your high wire, which I mentioned before, being a good one. And then you want to go with something that's going to be more controllable underneath it. And I'll be honest with you, this match with a little bit more of like a two and a half inch pin or so would mm-hmm. be really good for the start of team event and really good for the start of the doubles as well. So I'd bring one of those.
Great tips. So we want to thank Kyle for that question. And our last question, and to wrap this up, comes from V-Dub Tex. And he wants to know, can pin down layout be utilized for high track players? My track is next to my thumb hole. Have been told I can't use due to the track going over the hole if it's used.
Well, that's a good question. And that's based more on where your PAP is. So like, let's say, for example, if you have a bowling ball with lower differential, like let's say you have a match or a match pearl, and you put the pin just on the center line of your grip underneath your fingers, based off of your PAP, if your track is right next to your fingers and thumb, that pin might be 6.5 inches from your PAP, which absolutely would be too far, and you would definitely be at risk of it rumbling over the hole. So, and it wouldn't necessarily mean that putting it above the fingers would take care of that, but you want to make sure you have it in a little bit of an unstable position. So maybe 5 inches from your PAP would be where you'd want to go. Now, if you do a pin down layout and the pin is 5 inches from your PAP, you probably want to do that in an asymmetrical ball. But if you're going to do it in a symmetrical, you can stick with five and but go above your fingers. But it's all based off of where your PAP is located. So make sure you work off your PAP and don't worry about where it looks like on the surface of the ball.
Yeah, and a pro shop operator can help them determine what their PAP is, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, they can take and measure your track, have you roll a shot. They'll trace the oil ring, put it on the spinner or put it on their cup and determine exactly where your PAP is. So that's the number one rule of layouts for everything we were talking about today, is you have to know your PAP.
Awesome. So much awesome information. Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Storm and Roto, for producing some amazing bowling balls. I can't wait to throw them on tour. I hope you guys follow along, pwba.com. You can follow all the latest and greatest women's professional bowlers. Cheer on your favorites. Share. Just let's spread like wildfire and make sure that everybody knows that PWBA is back. And I think better than ever. I mean, this young talent out there, seriously, seriously good. And I know it's due to strong high school teams and especially strong college programs breeding amazing bowlers that are going on and now having the option to bowl on tour. So I'm excited to go out in a couple days to Sonoma Country in California, and then Sacramento, and then the Queens in Vegas, and then Wichita and Lincoln. And my poor kids are going to think I'm leaving them. I'm going to come back, I promise, hopefully with some money and some titles. Thanks, you guys, for tuning in. I hope you learned something. If you want us to do this again, leave a comment and let us know. I think Steve is just one of the best in the industry, and it's an honor for me to have this conversation with you. Thank you for spending so much time with us today.
Thanks, Deandra. Thanks for having me, and good luck out there on tour. And let's, like you said, don't just bring home one title. Let's bring home some titles.
Yeah, that's right. Cool. All right, you guys. See you next time. Bye.